This book shows the problems between Morocco and Algeria and the Sahrawis in the camps as pawns caught in a political game.
The Western Sahara is a tribal zone. How many tribes are there and who do they support, Morocco or the Polisario?
If we look at the structure of the tribes in there, the tribe that supports the Polisario is the Regibat, but it's only part of it because there are two factions of the Regibat. And also these Regibats also in the Western Sahara proper itself. So the tribal side is actually in favor of Morocco rather than the Polisario. And that is something that has been substantiated by anthropologists and sociologists, that the majority of the tribes are in Morocco because they in fact, even the Regibat tribe, it originates from the north of Morocco, where their spiritual leader is actually buried in near Wazan. They called Mshish, and he is the spiritual leader of the Regibat, who dominate the Western Saharan territory. But remember that the Western Sahara is just part of the whole of the Sahara. You have a mixture of tribes. You have the Shamas, the Tuaregs, and they're all sort of mixed in intertwined into one another. But the overwhelming majority is definitely in the Western Sahara proper, that is under Morocco's rule now.
The refugee camps in Tindouf for long standing. What hope do they have for the future?
I certainly have a lot of sympathy for those people because unfortunately they are trapped in the camps and trapped because they can't move. If you remember, the Sahrawis in general, the whole of the desert is their natural habitat. They shouldn't be confined into Tindouf because Tindouf is a military zone. Nobody can move without the authorization of the Algerian military. So therefore, these people are trapped. They don't have the status of refugees as we know it, because if they had, then they would be able to work. They are not doing that. They would be able to participate in the country's social and economic development. They are not doing that. They are completely isolated in the camps in Tindouf, and that area is a military zone. Nobody is allowed to come in or out without the authorization of the Algerian security forces.
And obviously, Ali, the author, is referring to the sort of tribal allegiance and which tribes want to be part of Morocco and which don't. And Stefan raised the question of the referendum earlier, which I'd like to come back to a little bit later. But before we do that, as you say, Roger, you've been following this dispute for a long time. It's been going on for 35 years. And some of it is not just about geography, is it? A lot of it's also been about political ideology, because before the fall of the Soviet Union, the sort of Algerian-Libyan camp tended to be more pro-Russian, if you like, and the Moroccan-Mauritania camp tended to be more pro-United States, Western, whatever camp. So some of this has also been about ideology as well, hasn't it? Not just about who owns which tract of land.
Yes, it has. I would like to make an important point about the size of the dispute.
Yeah.
The major issues today are that if you allow small groups of people and you ask them if they would like their independence, we have these in this country, many of them will say yes, they would. So there's one pressure to make smaller and smaller entities into self-governing,
like
sovereign
states. Right?
Wales, sure. Scotland, Ireland are examples, Northern Ireland. And on the other hand, if an area wishes to develop in a serious way, a larger entity is necessary. And the obvious examples are of China and India today, which have managed to develop despite all the things that are placed against them. So small disputes like this need to be seen in the broader context, and in this case, the broader context of the Sahara and the huge area which makes up the Sahara and all the territories which are around the Mediterranean. right the way down to the coasts of Africa, where there are huge resources, where Americans have major interests. And this is one small dispute which up to now hasn't affected the Americans very greatly, so it's been allowed to fester over time.
But maybe that's changing now because of concern over Al-Qaeda presence. But I think the point Roger raises, Stefan, about viability, if you like, is an interesting one, which presumably is why Morocco came forward with this autonomy option to basically say that, you know, the Western Sahara would govern itself economically through the tribal council, for want of a better description. But for defence and foreign affairs and all that, it would come within the sovereignty of the kingdom. I mean, do you actually think the Western Sahara would be viable as an independent state, free of Algerian influence, free of Moroccan influence, whatever? You think it could work as...
Well, I'm no expert on this side of governance, but in terms of it having a structures in place, the Polisario have been around for a long time, and in terms of governing structures, they're there. In terms of the wealth of the country, particularly with phosphates, which are essential for all industrial agriculture and which are a finite resource, apparently are going to be running out, peaking by 2050. And between 2007 and 2008, they rose by 800%, the cost of phosphates. So
really?
You can see a large percentage of the world's phosphates are beneath the arid sands of Western Sahara. So this is why, and it's not just the Moroccans who are exploiting that. Our countries, Western countries, as well as the fisheries, we've signed the EU fisheries agreement whereby we can plunder the richest fishing waters in the world. And therefore, it's not just a question or a dispute between Polisario and Morocco. It involves us all, and that's partly why I feel as if it's necessary to take an opinion. You say, as an Englishman, we don't need to take an opinion. But for me, in terms of international law, again, in terms of exploiting the mineral resources of a country that is a non-self-governing territory is against international law, and that's been ruled on by Hans Corell of the UN. Yeah. It's been ruled on by various people, and therefore we are breaching those laws.
But there are challenges to the way the Polisario is structured, obviously, isn't there? I mean, you know, of the 32 tribes that populate this area, 30 of them are not really very happy with the way the Polisario goes about its things, because it's still a very old-fashioned sort of socialist structure. I mean, North Korea is going down the tubes by anybody's judgment. So isn't the fear that the Polisario is a sort of pre-Soviet Union type ideological concept would just drive it down the same route? Isn't that one of the fears critics have?
And partly this book is looking very much into the history, and you talk about how the Polisario developed in those times with the Socialist Republic and Algeria and the Libyans, and also they were very strongly aligned to the ANC as well. The ANC would train in Western
And do you think
Sahara.
That's moved on now since
We've
the fall of the Cold
way
War
since
and all
then,
that?
And yeah. I've worked with and met and attended conferences and gone to the refugee camps and met the Polisario leaders. And I must say, I've worked with the ANC, I've worked with politicians from people around the world, and I've been impressed with the people I've met in the Polisario. And I think this idea that Ali talks about the refugees being trapped in these refugee camps, they are, and it's tragic, but it's not because of the Polisario, it's because of the situation where the Moroccans have built the longest wall, 1,500-mile wall, which is the most heavily mined, crossing the territory, stopping the Sahrawis returning to their homeland and meeting their families.
I'd like to deal with that. I think just by way of introduction to that, there is a big chunk in the book that deals with the United Nations and the refugees and this whole issue. So I think let's take a look at that extract from the book now that looks at the United Nations dilemma when it comes to the refugees.